Today we have Austin Holland with us. Austin is a seismologist with the Oklahoma Geological Survey. Welcome, Austin.
Thank you.
So Austin got his education first, his bachelor's degree at the University of Idaho. He then did his master's work at the University of Texas, El Paso. And then he went to work for 12 years at the Idaho National Engineering Lab. Since leaving there, he joined the Oklahoma Geological Survey, where he's been doing work on seismic activity in the state of Oklahoma. So recently, there's been a significant increase in seismic activity in the state, and people are asking a lot of questions. I understand you're the one that a lot of them are coming to for answers. Can you give the students some background on what the latest is in terms of the seismic activity and its uptick in frequency?
Sure. Oklahoma's always had earthquakes. We've had a seismic monitoring network since the late 1970s, so we're well poised to look at this earthquake increase. So we've seen roughly 80 times more earthquakes than we had previously. That's just a remarkable number. But in addition, we've also had a number of additional seismic stations in the state. Part of the National Science Foundation EarthScope program was moving this U.S. array of these seismic stations and translating them across the country, and they're now on the East Coast. But at the time when the earthquakes first started really ticking up here in Oklahoma in late 2009, all these stations were in the state. So we were able to learn and are learning a lot more about these earthquakes as they continue to occur. So we're having roughly 100 or more than 100 felt earthquakes every year. And we used to average about 1 to 3, maybe 5 earthquakes a year that would be felt by local residents.
So it was highly fortuitous then that this array was where it was when it was there, in terms of having all these additional monitoring stations.
Yes, and it was part of the reason they rushed to bring me into the Geological Survey when they did, is we were down some staff, and they had this need to bring in this this data and incorporate it into the regional network. And so we did that, and it was just an amazing resource, and we're still, I mean, we have decades worth of science to be done with this incredible data set.
So how easy is it to deploy these meters to detect this activity?
It takes a few days to build one of these things, and of course they're not cheap. They're very sensitive seismic equipment. They record earthquakes of magnitude 4 plus around the world, or if you put them too close to trains or roads, you get to record a lot of cars and trains as well.
So a lot of this activity lately has been happening in the Edmond area. Some of it's been happening down south, south central Oklahoma. Is there some kind of relationship in terms of where these occurrences are, in terms of other activities, in terms of faults, and that kind of thing?
So a large part of our seismicity, both current and in the past, occurs within about 35 miles of the Nemaha fault system. It's a very large fault system. It runs from south central Oklahoma up sort of parallel to I-35 on into Kansas and then on up into Nebraska. So it's a very large complex fault system with a lot of blocks and associated secondary structures and that sort of thing. And most of our seismicity occurs within some 35 miles of that fault. But a lot of it is, you know, kind of spread out and broad. We've been seeing activity continuing in eastern Oklahoma counties at a very significant rate for 4 years now. So that's a very long time to have this very increased level of seismic activity and this uptick for 4 years. And it's truly a remarkable earthquake swarm that's been a little bit bewildering since we started looking at it. Some of these Edmond quakes look like the northwest extension of that, and then some look a little different. So, you know, there's always a difficulty in understanding what's going on deep inside the earth when we can't see it but through these very crude methods in a way.
So there's been some connections made in other states with recent earthquake activity, such as Arkansas, Texas, Ohio, where they're making a connection between increased earthquake activity and the disposal of wastewater from oil and gas operations in deep underground injection wells. Does that have something to do with the increased uptick in activity?
It's likely that it does. And so identifying the cases that might be related to these saltwater disposal wells is really quite a challenge here in Oklahoma, because these things have been operating for decades and years. It is a real challenge to find the links. We have more than 10,000 UIC Class II wells. That's the wells that are allowed to inject for oil and gas activities into these deep aquifers that don't contain drinking water. And so, you know, it's something we're looking at. Identifying which sequences might be related to saltwater disposal is a real challenge. We had a recent case in Love County, just north of Marietta, where there was a series of earthquakes that occurred about 2 weeks after injection started in a well. But this area has had earthquake swarms that have been shallow in the past. OGS has tried to put out instruments to record these swarms and has been unable to get good locations for these earthquakes. And so we were able to get some instruments out and record some really good data for these earthquakes. And we're working on a project that would allow us to state with scientific accuracy whether earthquakes are caused by reinjecting in that well or not. So we're looking at ways to accurately identify cases where we can say that wells may be causing earthquakes. But it is continuing work, and we're working on these sorts of cases all the time. It seems like every new sequence of earthquakes, someone suggests, you know, disposal wells, and of course we're continuing to look into that.
So what would be the mechanism in terms of, you know, if the seismic activity is in fact induced because of wastewater disposal, what would be the mechanism that would cause that?
What you have to have is an earth that's basically critically stressed. You have a fault that's at that rupture point where it just takes a small amount of change to cause it to rupture. And so the actual mechanism that's generally turned to trigger these earthquakes is you are injecting pressure in the subsurface, or water at pressure in the subsurface, and sometimes this can be pretty low pressure, but as the water builds a column in the well, it can generate significant pressures. And so this pressure then is transmitted through the earth, and it moves slowly but faster than the actual water travels. And this pressure then can interact with these faults. You effectively reduce the friction on the fault, so you partly push the fault apart ever so slightly with this additional pressure, and if the fault's ready to slip, then it can slip.
We've talked in this course earlier about the role of the Oklahoma Corporation Commission in the state in terms of being the regulatory entity for oil and gas. They're also the regulatory entity for the UIC program, the Underground Injection Control Program. Have you been working with them at all on this issue?
Absolutely. We're in contact probably every week, if not every day at times. So, you know, we work closely together. Of course, the Geological Survey is not a regulatory body. We're a research and public information body. And so we try to inform them with the best science we can and hopefully help them make good decisions and just provide them the information that we can provide that they don't have the expertise to provide themselves.
What about the Oklahoma Geological Survey in terms of the public? Do you do things to perhaps help the public better understand what's going on?
Absolutely. So at times we've held town hall meetings. I do a lot of talks to civic groups. I give interviews to the media. We do whatever we can to inform the public. We release a lot of publications that are available to the public, and we don't copyright our materials so that others can use that material for educational purposes. So a big part of our mission is interacting and educating the public.
Well, I'm glad you had time to stop in today and talk with us. And we really appreciate it. Thank you.
Thank you.